Hey everybody, welcome back. We're getting pretty close here to being able to start writing some assembly code, but before we get to that, one of the things that we need to do is get some of our documentation that we need, because we're going to reference that documentation to be able to write our assembly language code. There's some key registers or memory locations that we need to know about, and I wanted to go through the process that I go through with you so that you can see how I bring that documentation in, how I look through it, and how I find stuff to be able to be able to write the code. So let's first of all go to our browser here and look at HiFive. So we need our board is the HiFive one built by HiFive. So if we go to the HiFive.com, whoops, I misspelled that. So let's try that again. HiFive.com website. Essentially, we will get to here. I encourage you to kind of scan through the site. In our case, we're looking at boards and software, and the board we care about is this HiFive One board. And so you can see that there's other boards that HiFive makes called Freedom Unleashed. This is a Linux board, but we're interested in this microcontroller, and we're going to hit on learn more. And if we scroll down here a little bit, we'll see that there's some documentation that's available. But let's look at a couple of things. One is, this is actually the HiFive One board. It's a nice picture of it. And you'll see that right here, this is the actual RISC-V processor. So there's actually two pieces of documentation that we need. We need one piece of documentation, which is for the whole board and how the board is set up. And then the other piece of documentation, the one we're going to use the most, is for actually this processor. And you can see that this processor, the microcontroller, is called the HiFive Freedom E310. And that's really the documentation we care the most about. So if we scroll down, we can see that there's two pieces of documentation we can get: the HiFive One Getting Started Guide, and then the E310 manual. So let's just right-click on that, save that, and then let's go to our platformio, our projects. Here's our SuperBlink project, and let's create a new folder called Docs. Whoops. And then inside the Docs folder, we're going to save this Getting Started. And then we're going to do the same thing for the E310 manual. So save link as, and we're going to save our E310 manual. And voila, we've now saved that through. So let's go to Visual Studio Code, back to our environment. And what you'll notice here immediately, the docs folder showed up. And so in the docs folder is our two PDF files. So if you recall when we started all this, I said that I had an extension here called VS Code-PDF, and that's what's going to let me read those PDF files and do it all from within the Visual Studio Code environment. So it's very handy. I'll never have to leave the environment to go do this. I go back to my files, and if I click on the HiFive One Getting Started, now you'll get this first message here that says, hey, do you want to display? You just say yes, and then it'll scan through and show you the PDF file. I'm going to get rid of our build routine, and let's start at the top. So you can see here on the left, it shows you the table of contents for the document. And one of the things that's really nice here is having a picture of the board, highlights everything that's on the board. Obviously, what we care about in our SuperBlink is the RGB LED, and we're going to be addressing that. And as I pointed out to you before, here's the RISC-V SoC, the FE310 that we care about. The other part of this documentation is actually at the very end here, where it says the Freedom E310 pinout. And usually when you're doing work with microcontrollers, you want to know what all these pins do here. You can see here awake, IO ref, reset and stuff, all of these pins. And so if you go here, you'll find out the definition of all of these pins. And so for us, what's relevant here is green, blue, and red. That's the LEDs we care about. And we can see that they're mapped to these pin numbers. Now, if you come from the Arduino world and you did the pin mode output, this is the pin you would have specified in there. But now we're writing assembly language, and we're going to be talking directly to the GPIO memory location. And in that regards, we're going to need this GPIO offset. And this offset represents a bit field, and I'll go through that so that you can understand exactly what this 19, 21, and 22 represents as we go through. Now, the other piece of documentation is the FE310. You can see it popped open. And I'll start at the beginning here in the introduction. The thing we care the most about as we go through this documentation is something called the memory map. So if you scan down through here, and obviously this will become more familiar as you spend time with the manual, there's a thing here called the memory map. And it says the memory map is shown in table 3.1, so we'll click on that. Here's the memory map for this E310. And the reason why the memory map's important is because we're going to be using the GPIO, the general purpose IO, and we need to know what its memory location is. So you can see its memory location here is shown as 0x1001-2000. And then from there, and this is the base and then the top of the address. And so this entire set represents all of the GPIO memory locations. So now that we know what the base address is, we want to know what each one of these memory location does. So if we scan through this documentation, you'll see that there's a chapter specifically on the GPIO. Obviously, I encourage you to read through all of this, but here's our GPIO, and it says here's the memory map for the GPIO. And so it says, hey, the memory map for the GPIO is shown as table 17-1. So here's the offset off that GPIO register. So I showed you from the HiFive 1 memory map what the base address was. And then so from that base address, here's the offset values and what each one of those mean. And just to give you an indication, this are things like pin input enable, pin output enable. So if you're, again, if you're familiar with Arduino and you've done this pin mode input or output, this is actually the bits that get set when you do that. And this would be a pin input value. Now, when we write to the output port, when we want to do this, is what we do. We do this on this port offset. We actually write the output. I don't use much of these other ones, but there's one other important one for our exercise, which is the last one here, which is called out XOR. So it took me a while to figure this out, and I actually, to be honest, didn't figure it out. I got some help from the folks at SciFive to explain this to me. It turns out that the pins on the board and the LEDs especially are what's called active low. That means that when the bit is set to zero, the LED is on. And when the bit is set to one, the LED is off. That's its default state. And so I find that, you know, somewhat confusing or counterintuitive is probably the better word, counterintuitive, because I'd like to have bit, if the bit is set to zero, for the LED to be off, and if the bit is set to one, the LED to be on. And so in order to make it intuitive, you have this option, which is the output XOR. So essentially invert your expectations. And so we're going to use that in order to set that default behavior to be active high instead of active low. So those are key pieces of documentation. Again, at the very beginning, I pointed out the RISC-V reader. It's going to also be very important. I don't have a digital copy that I can put up for you. So really get a copy of that book so you can follow along, because I'll be using some of that. But this is the base documentation that will allow us to get started with writing our assembly language code.